So, thank you all for being here. This is our Deep Focus seminar series. It's a continuing series of online discussions, which is sponsored by the VESTA Fund, which allows us to present these seminars for free online. So I'm really glad that everyone here is taking advantage of such a great opportunity to hear folks such as Alan talk about like their favorite films. My name is Kyle Stenger. I am the director of outreach for the Garden Theater in Princeton, New Jersey. I just want to welcome the members of the Garden Theater. I want to welcome the members of the County Theater, the Ambler Theater, the Highway Theater, and the Gettysburg Theater. Thank you so much all for being here. I want to let everyone know about some upcoming Deep Focus seminars. So before we get started on tonight's, just so everyone knows, if you want to see Psycho on the big screen, it's already played at most of our theaters, but it's playing tomorrow on Halloween night at the Ambler Theater. So if you still want to get out and see it in a cinema, tomorrow's your chance. Otherwise, you're going to have to watch it at home. Wednesday, the Garden Theater and the Ambler Theater are playing The Setup, the Robert Wise boxing film. Thursday, it's playing at the County Theater. That is part of our Hollywood Classics series, just as Psycho is part of the Hollywood Classics series. That seminar will be on Tuesday, November 7th, and that will be hosted by Turner Classic Movies' Hannah Jack. The next Deep Focus will be Elevator to the Gallows, which is part of our music and film jazz series. And if you're not aware, Miles Davis does a killer score for that one. We will have that plays on November 7th at the County and November 8th at the Garden and the Ambler Theater. So if you haven't seen that one, it's a great Louis Malle film. Check it out. The Deep Focus series seminar will be Monday, November 20th. And that was with Josh Lawrence, who is a musician and the director of jazz studies at the Interlochen Center for the Arts. And the last scheduled Deep Focus seminar that we have coming up is in December, on the 12th of December, also with Hannah Jack from Turner Classic Movies. And that one will be The Apartment, which we played over the summer. So we don't have plans to show it again beforehand. So if you got to see it on one of our screens over the summer, that is wonderful. If you haven't, I suggest either you get a copy or just rent it or somehow watch that movie. Watch all of Billy Wilder's movies, as a matter of fact. But that one is superb. Okay, we're just going to move on for tonight's show. Alan Amtzis is the director of the Masters of Education Instruction Program at the College of New Jersey, where he also teaches a course called Terms of EnQueerMent, a History of LGBTQ Film and Media. He holds a master's degree in film studies from Columbia University, where he wrote his thesis on Max Ophuls' The Earrings of Madame D, which is a beautiful film. I just will add that. His lifelong love of movies began at age 5 when he saw his first film in a movie theater, tonight's Psycho. Prior to becoming an educator, he worked as a script reader and as a casting director for films, music videos, and commercials. He appeared briefly as a featured extra in the costume party scene of Jonathan Demme's 1993 Philadelphia as the Pope. But don't blink or you'll miss his moment. He is a proud member of the County Theater, and he's thrilled to be part of Renew Theater's Deep Focus series. So, Psycho is the movie that got me into movies way back in high school. I'm super excited to talk about it with Alan and with everyone here. Going forward, if you after Alan's presentation, if you have a question or a comment, you can either raise your hand physically like that, or Zoom provides a feature where you can press a button and it will raise a little emoji hand. Otherwise, you can always use the chat feature. If you don't feel comfortable talking to all of us or being on screen, you can write a question or a comment in the chat. And I will do my best to acknowledge all of those. Also appreciate Lisa Roberts with the Bates Motel neon. Great. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Alan now. Thank you all again for being here, and let's get started.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And I want to thank you all for showing up on this mostly rainy Monday night, if you're here in the Northeast. I want to thank you for showing up for this film. And I really want to thank the County Theater and Renew and Julia and Chris for asking me to host this particular film. As you've already heard, and you'll hear more, it's an enormously important film in my life, for reasons that are probably obvious already, but I will amplify. When Julia and Chris asked me if I would host this, I really was ecstatic. I just thought it felt like winning an award for some category I didn't even know I was nominated in. So it's really very, very, very exciting. So I've got about 25 minutes of sort of presentation. And within that, there'll be a film clip or two and maybe a pause for an audience question to you. And then we'll have about a half an hour to really have a conversation and a discussion and a Q&A if that's what people need it to be. Although you need to remember, I've done a lot of homework on this movie, but I'm not Alfred Hitchcock. So sometimes the answer might be, I don't know, but maybe one of you does. So why don't we just get started? I'm going to share my screen right now with this and this. And whoops, hold on 1 minute. And oh, come on. Oh, I need to move something just a second. There we go. Okay. You should be looking at my screen. If somebody can give me a thumbs up. Thank you. Great. So I don't know how many of you have never seen this movie before. I'm assuming you've all seen it at least once. If you've never seen it, warning, plenty of spoilers coming up. So I apologize, but even if there are spoilers, it won't ruin the movie for you. Although Alfred Hitchcock was adamant that people don't enter the theater 5 minutes after the movie started, but we'll talk more about that. So here we go. So good evening. I usually try to say that in my best Alfred Hitchcock voice. Good evening. For those of you who are old enough to remember his sort of morbid, menacing, threatening presence on weekly television in the 50s, that was always how he began his television show, Alfred Hitchcock Presents. So I want to start with a personal connection that you know a little bit about. You already know that this was the first movie. Yes. I see some of my Bronx friends cheering on. This is Allerton Avenue in the Bronx, which is the theater where I saw Psycho for the first time. Psycho was, as you already know, the first film I saw in a theater. I was 5 years old. And an obvious question is, who would take a five-year-old to this movie? And the answer is my 13-year-old sister, who had to babysit me that day, and all her friends were going to the movies, and she just wanted to go. And she thought, oh, he likes movies, I'll take him. So there you go. And when I tell people that this is the first movie I saw in a theater, they invariably ask me if I'm afraid of showers. The truth is, I'm not. I'm not afraid of showers, but I am afraid of motels. I will not stay in a motel. So a little later in this evening, I'm going to share a closing personal connection with you that I hope you'll find funny. At least I think it is. But that's the Allerton Theater where I first saw it. So there you go. So this film for me is an unexpectedly personal experience. It's a movie that's surprisingly emotionally engaging, considering it's about very sad, unsavory things. And it was definitely personal for Alfred Hitchcock. I mean, I think all his movies were, but this one in particular was a labor of absolute willpower and love for him. And as you'll hear, getting it made cost him a lot, literally. He Paramount withdrew all financial support from it, and he and his wife Alma Revile had to mortgage their house in order to pay for it. So he really did personally and literally own this movie, and it luckily for him, it was a huge success. Otherwise, he would have been broke, I guess. So it was a personal experience for me, certainly for Hitchcock, and I hope for you. After this presentation, we can certainly do a Q&A if people want, but I really want to hear what you think, what you remember, what you feel, and mostly why you think this movie is such a perennial classic, why it has lasted so long and seems to be the iconic Hitchcock film, or one of them anyway. So I want to start at the very beginning. I want to play two film clips for you. They're very short. One is a minute, the other is about a minute and a half. Hopefully I can make the sound work. So I want to start with the very opening moments, which are the credits, which set the tone through music and graphics before we even see a single frame of footage. So give me just a second to transition. There we go. And then we go here. Okay. So I am going to play a very short clip from the opening of the credits. And let's see if I can do this right. Share with sound. And we'll share this and this. So get ready to hear some lovely Bernard Herrmann music. Okay, so audience question number one, what does that contribute? What does that tell us about this movie? What are some of the emotions, feelings, thoughts? What does this conglomeration of picture and sound, of image and sound set us up for? This is not a rhetorical question. I'm actually asking people. I see Cheryl, you had your hand up first. I think you need to unmute.
Yeah, I did it. Okay, now I did it. I think for me, it's very frantic. The music is really frantic. And I know it shows up later on in the movie at certain times. And it also, it's that feeling of like being out of control kind of thing. And then interwoven in that is kind of like, then you get that orchestral kind of music, which kind of like comes in between, like, and kind of like maybe settles you a little bit. And then all of a sudden it's back to like the frantic again kind of thing. And I kind of think of it a little bit almost like Norman Bates himself, like, you know, at one point he's frantic, you know, and crazed. And at the next point, he's kind of like, just like a mild mannered kind of milquetoast kind of, you know, when he's himself, you know, man running a motel.
That's, yeah, I think you're onto something. Certainly the main theme in the music for the titles is very jagged, very jarring, very unsettling. And it matches that sort of jigsaw puzzle of the credits with things splitting up and flying away. And then, yes, in the middle of that is that very melodious string section, which we hear, I think, the first time in the movie when Marion is driving on that long drive out of Phoenix. And I think it sets up a real kind of sad longing, a kind of desperation. I mean, Marion is, you know, running away with $40,000, hoping it will buy her and Sam a future. But she's starting to realize it's not quite going to. But there's definitely a tenderness and a yearning in her. And I think both of those themes do exactly what you said. They set us up for the movie that we're about to see. So I'm going to share my screen again, my PowerPoint, which is here. And in a moment, we're going to see... Okay. So those credits really belong to Saul Bass and Bernard Herrmann, who were instrumental, no pun intended, in creating this movie. This movie is almost unthinkable without Bernard Herrmann's music. Although he wasn't the sound designer. There are lots of sound effects and sounds you're going to hear about that other people contributed to. And Saul Bass worked very closely with Hitchcock on the storyboards and designing the look of the film. There's a lot of legend and lore about whether Saul Bass directed the shower scene, but we'll get to that a little bit later. Now I want to show I want to look at the opening scene for a second. So I'm going to stop sharing, and I'm going to play, again, just a few moments, maybe a minute of, let me just switch here. The very opening scene of the movie, some of you may remember this quite closely, of course. Here we go. Right after the credits.
Never did eat your lunch, did you?
I better get back to the office. These extended lunch hours give my boss excess acid.
Why don't you call your boss and tell him you're taking the rest of the afternoon off? Friday anyway, and hot.
What do I do with my free afternoon? Walk you to the airport?
Well, you could laze around here a while longer.
Checking out time is 3 p.m. Hotels of this sort aren't interested in you when you come in, but when your time is up... Oh, Sam, I hate having to be with you in a place like this.
Well, I've heard of married couples who deliberately spend an occasional night in a cheap hotel.
When you're married, you can do a lot of things deliberately.
All right, I'm going to stop that right there because otherwise we'll just get sucked into watching the whole movie. So I'm going to go back to the PowerPoint for just a moment. Thank you for your patience. Actually, before I do that, let's talk about that scene. So the scene starts with a wide pan across the city of Phoenix. And these titles come up telling us what day it is, what time it is, what location. And it's an odd combination of very random and very specific. We know not only what day it is, we know it's 2 weeks before Christmas. We know exactly what time in the afternoon it is, 2:43. And then the camera goes in through this little peek hole in the window underneath these like cheesy, cheap blinds. And we come into a rather cheap hotel room. And there we see, and this really kind of is not a secret. If you've done any study of Hitchcock's themes, you know that one of his major themes is voyeurism. And we're going to talk about that for a minute or two. So it's like we're these sort of, you know, we're where Peeping Tom's going in through a window where there's a very private conversation happening between two people who are not married, and it's clearly desperation. They have to meet in secret and furtively. And by the way, speaking of voyeurism, in this movie, Janet Leigh, who admittedly had rather large breasts, wears the biggest brassieres I've ever seen in a movie. And you can't not notice them. In one scene, it's bright blazing white. And another subsequent scene, it's black. But they're big. And I think Hitchcock wants us to notice, look, she's in her underwear. And somehow that's a kind of, you know, Peeping Tom-ish kind of reinforcement for Hitchcock. So I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint. Give me just a second. Here we go. Okay. So that was the opening scene. And again, you know, there's this pan across Phoenix. We go in through the window. And there we see all these sort of details that just say, you know, a secret furtive lunch. And the dialogue reinforces that. Again, I mentioned the brassieres, costuming by Rita Riggs, sort of, who was uncredited, by the way. I mean, Hitchcock wants us to really, the first 40 minutes of this movie are about gazing at Marion Crane. By the way, those of you who've seen any number of Hitchcock movies know he was a big fan of putting himself in his movies, and he liked to do it very early on. In this one, his little cameo is very early and very quick, and you don't even see his face. Right after the scene we just saw, when Marion returns, he's standing outside in a cowboy hat. I'm not even sure if he turns toward the camera, but if you ever watch it again, that's where he is. That's our guy. So getting Psycho made, as I said, was a labor of love and willpower for Hitch, because Paramount rescinded all their funding. The previous movies he had made were really these Technicolor champagne cocktails. You know, there was To Catch a Thief on the Riviera. There was North by Northwest, both with Cary Grant. And they wanted another, you know, glitzy, beautiful, colorful comic suspense movie. You know, their biggest star at that point was probably Audrey Hepburn, who represented a certain kind of class. And Hitchcock wanted to make this black and white shabby film about small people with secrets, and Paramount said absolutely not. So Hitchcock used his own production company from his television show to fund it, you know, hoping, of course, that it would be a hit. Luckily for him, it was. The source material was written by Robert Bloch, who was mostly famous for writing really cheap pulp fiction that's sort of a half step above softcore porn. You know, the heroes of his stories were always strippers and magicians and hustlers and people who really are desperate and on the fringes of society. So that's where the novel comes from the mind of Robert Bloch. And of course, there's rumors that it's based on a very famous serial killer at the time, but and that may be true. So Hitchcock had decided that, you know, it was not unusual in the late 50s for there to be these lurid crime melodramas, and inspired by other filmmakers who were less talented than him, he sort of set a publicity stunt in motion by ordering complete secrecy around this film. He ordered his assistants to buy up any copy of the book they could find in a bookstore, because he didn't want anyone reading it before the movie came out. The cast had to take an oath of allegiance that they would not talk about what happened on set. No press was allowed on the set. But later on, after the movie was made and released, there's a full disclosure. He practically gives away the entire plot of the movie in a trailer that stars him and takes 6 minutes long. I don't think we see 6 minute long trailers anymore, but that was his release. So let's talk for a minute about the elephant in the room, which is two words and 45 seconds that kind of changed the world of cinema, certainly changed the way people wrote about cinema, that's for sure. Obviously, I'm talking about the shower scene. Now, technically, I know that's three words, but I'm not counting the. So the shower scene just really, you know, it's the centerpiece of the film. It's a dividing point in the film. It's probably, you know, it's history is that it's 76 shots in 45 seconds. You'll see variations on that. Hitchcock sometimes said 76 shots, sometimes said 78 shots. It depends on where you start counting or start ending. But in 45 seconds, a lot happens. You know, there's an intruder. Well, Marion disrobes, gets in the shower, turns on the shower, starts soaping up. An intruder comes in, starts stabbing her. She screams, she falls, and ultimately she dies. And that scream, that image of her screaming is iconic. So let's talk a little bit about the shower scene. It's probably the most famous editing since the 1920s with Eisenstein's montage theories in Battleship Potemkin. And certainly the shower scene is based on a similar concept that editing can make a scene. I've tried to think about what the shower scene might look like if other people had filmed it, particularly Max Ophuls, who was famous for long shots and moving camera. It would look very, very different. So the shower scene, by the way, has its own 90-minute documentary called 7842. As I said, it depends on where you start counting. But if you go online, you can watch a 90-minute documentary just about the shower scene, which, as I said, is really the centerpiece of the film for a very important reason. It's also the center of critical analysis, as I said. If you go onto Google and you type in psycho, there are more than 365 million hits. It's an awful lot for a movie that's 65 years old. Why? What is so compelling about Psycho? Why has it spawned such a devoted fan base? And why does it have such an iconic presence? I hope this is what we'll talk about after this little presentation. This is what I want to hear from you. Why Psycho is such a compelling movie? And part of it, frankly, is not just Janet Leigh's performance, which I think is lovely, but I think because we so completely identify with Marion Crane, and then, well, you know what happens to her. So the movie came out in the middle of a wave of critical analysis on Hitchcock in general, largely spurred on by the French semiotic Freudian psychoanalytic film critics like Roland Barthes, Christian Metz, Umberto Eco, Gilles Deleuze, and others. So it's in the middle of a whole slew of very demented movies like Vertigo and Rear Window and The Birds, which are all sort of Freudian, to be honest. And speaking of Freudian, look at the plot theme of this movie. If you boil it down and try to explain to someone that it's about a young man who murders his mother when he finds her in bed with her lover, and then embalms her body and assumes her identity, and then murders several young women that he's attracted to while dressed as his mother, you can understand why Paramount said, no way. There's no way we're making this movie. I mean, what kind of a plot summary is that? So I want to return for a moment to a major Hitchcockian thing, voyeurism, which is threaded throughout this movie, especially in relation to Marion Crane, the Janet Leigh character. Norman Bates, who is the other main character in this movie, has a painting hanging in his office called Susanna, I forget the full title, Susanna Bathing or Susanna Raped While Bathing or something that indicates she's having a private moment in the water with intruders. There are lots of moments in this movie where people are focusing a lot of energy and attention on Marion Crane. My personal favorite is this one, the state trooper, who generally looks very scary, and she meets him when she's sleeping, but there are a lot of men gazing at her in this movie. And then, of course, we get to watch her, you know, in an enormously private moment that we haven't seen before in many movies, which is a young woman showering. And there's a lot of interpretation of this scene that I'm not going to get into because I'm not sure how I feel about it. One important little note before we discuss the editing. It's reportedly the first American movie that actually shows a toilet, which has a plot point. She tears up some figures and throws them in the toilet, but they don't all flush down. Paramount was not happy about that either. So here we see Norman sort of spying on Marion. He takes the painting away. There's a hole in the wall. And we get this close-up of his eye looking at her illuminated. Somehow she doesn't seem to notice this is happening. And he's watching her in the shower and getting aroused. And this is what he sees. Janet Leigh in another one of her very architectural brassieres, this one black. And again, this is a very lurid 1950s Pulp Fiction image that that Psycho sort of functions in. So the question that I love to ask about this, that I hope we'll also discuss, is who are we in this moment? We're viewers of a movie, but are we also voyeurs? Are we passive? And somehow are we complicit in this crime? Well, literally we're not, but emotionally, are we somehow part of it because we're gazing at it? And I chose these two images because here, Marion does something that is a classic Hitchcock gesture. She reaches out toward the camera, maybe even to us, for help. What you see down here is a shot from Dial M for Murder. Grace Kelly, who's backwards on a desk, is about to be, or attempted murder. She doesn't die, but she also, in a movie that's in 3D, reaches out through the 3D to us for help. And of course, we're paralyzed. We can't help them. We can only watch, sadly, while we watch Marion's life slip away in drips and drabs as her blood goes down the drain. Blood, by the way, that most people probably know is chocolate syrup. One minor point, it's not Hershey's chocolate syrup, it's some other brand, because it was the only brand that came available in a squeeze tube. And by using the squeeze tube, they were able to release it in quantities that they want to. But we basically watch Marion's life slip away. And then the reach is echoed when Norman comes in and sees it. He's horrified because he has no idea that he's actually been part of it. And he reaches out, you know, maybe not to us, but to sort of push away the horror that he's just witnessed. And this is probably the most important moment in the movie. It's the narrative that breaks. For 40 minutes, Marion has been our emotional center. We've been sympathetic, empathetic. Whether we, you know, think she did a bad thing or not, we feel sorry for her. She's acted out of not even passion, just desperation. But her murder 40 minutes into it means we don't have a main character anymore. And it's very strange. There she is, yeah, her life slipping away. And we get this shot of her blood going down the drain, swirling down, and it cuts to her eyeball, her dead, lifeless eyeball, which, by the way, they had to do 26 takes on because it was held for a full minute and she kept blinking. And Hitchcock really, really kind of got a little angry with her. So what they decided to do was they just reprinted some of it in the editing so it looks seamless, like it's one shot, but it's really one image about 50 times or something, not a continuous shot. One other interesting thing about the shower scene is that in the rehearsal, the actor who was playing Norman Bates' mother, which was not Anthony Perkins, who was in a play in New York at that time, he kind of wasn't really stabbing very vigorously, and Janet Leigh wasn't screaming very vigorously, and Hitchcock lost his patience and jumped up and said, "For heaven's sake, it's supposed to be like this." And he started stabbing at her with this rubber knife, and she got hysterical screaming. And he said, "There, can we now do that?" So it's kind of interesting that he was a bit impatient with her during the rehearsal process. But as I said, this movie takes away our sympathetic heroine. And I do want to reassure you, they were actually good friends. They didn't hold a grudge against each other. There are lots of shots of them laughing. But this is the important thing. In that moment, we shift our empathy to someone who's a very unsavory, sad, disturbed character. He's a serial killer who's taken over by instincts he doesn't even understand. And it's a very tricky thing to switch our allegiance from this sympathetic young woman to this not very sympathetic and uber creepy young man. There's a wonderful moment after the shower scene when Norman cleans it up, thinking, you know, he's protecting his mother. He goes back to his house and he walks down this corridor and sits in this sad, lonely little confined space. And he just looks so lonely and alone. I find this image rather heartbreaking, considering we've just watched him murder somebody viciously. It's a very, very affecting moment, I think. And then right after that, he has to get rid of Marion's body and her car because he doesn't want people finding it. And it's a famous sequence where he drives her car into a swamp and it starts to sink and it almost gets submerged, but then it stops. And there's this kind of weird thing that happens where we know that he's done this terrible thing, but I think there's this emotional, the way it's edited, our emotions like, oh no, it's not going to sink. It's not going to sink. And then after about 10 seconds, it continues and it submerges completely. And the audience is kind of relieved. And it's very bizarre because we suddenly realize we've just been like sympathetic to a mass murderer. It's very strange. So to make this movie, Alfred Hitchcock, again, funding it on his own, had to reject all of the top shelf people that Paramount would have paid for. And he used his television show crew who worked for scale, with the exception of his editor, George Tomasini. Everybody, the cinematographer, the art directors, the sound design, they all came from television production and were used to working faster and a lot less. This movie was shot in 30 days, which is, you know, unheard of in a major motion picture. So just a reminder that this all started with two writers, of course, Robert Bloch, the novel, and Joseph Stefano, who had to adapt it for the screenplay. Just a word about how it was filmed. A lot of people are wondering about this particular shot in the murder, because the camera doesn't seem to get wet, and it's literally right under the shower head. I tried to find a shot that showed this, but what they did was they plugged up the center holes so that it would only spray outward. And the camera was pretty far away, and they used a long telephoto lens, so it looked like the camera was much closer than it was. By the way, the designers obviously designed a bathroom. It's not a real bathroom in a real small motel. It's a movie set, so everything in it moved away. The ceiling, the walls, the tub, everything was movable so the camera could be where Hitchcock needed it to be. The other segment that people wonder about the filming of, because it's so strange, is later in the film when the private detective Arbogast is murdered. He's murdered at the top of the steps by this figure that looks like an old woman. It's Norman dressed as his mother, and he stabs Arbogast, the actor Martin Baum, who falls backward. And what happens is he's not really falling. He's sort of on a green screen kind of thing. And what they're doing is they're moving the rear projection forward while they're moving the rear projection outward while the camera is zooming in forward. So it creates this very difficult to negotiate space, which makes sense because he's falling backwards down a flight of stairs after being stabbed. So just a few more slides. I want to talk about the design of the film. The sound designer was William Russell, who again worked from television, and he came up with some of the major sound effects that aren't musical in the film, including the stabbing. When I watched the film at the county last week, the stabbing scene, the noise of the stabbing was really effective. It was a big butcher knife stabbing into a watermelon. Something about the watermelon really created the right sound. And there's also something that happens during Marion's murder and also during Arbogast's murder, which is musical, but it wasn't Bernard Herrmann. It's a kind of shrieking sound. I don't know enough about musical instruments to know what it is, but it almost sounds like a human shrieking. And that was the sound design by William Russell. The one moment that Hitch may have gotten in trouble for that the censors wanted to talk about, Hitchcock promised that there would never at any time be a scene of the knife going into Marion's flesh, that was the censors wouldn't tolerate that. But what you see in this one shot is they start with a body double and the blade seems to be in her skin, but they're actually pulling it out. And so what you're seeing is a reverse shot, but then they reversed it in the editing so it looked like it was going in, but it actually never goes into her skin. It was they cut it at just the exact frame before the censors would have said, we're not approving this film. And of course, you know, the design is sort of famous, especially for the mansion here that, and there you can see up in the top Mother Bates. I'm not going to talk much more about George Tomasini since we talked about the editing of the film. Saul Bass and Bernard Herrmann really were central here. This movie was, as was typical for Hitchcock, who storyboarded, but Psycho in particular was storyboarded so that nothing was left to chance. Every angle, every scene was broken down into filmic units. And it is true that during the filming of the shower scene, Hitchcock had a terrible flu. And there's lots of rumor that Saul Bass really shot the scene. It's not true. The crew worked with Saul Bass's design, but actually Hitchcock's wife, Alma Revile, who was his better half for sure, sort of supervised the shooting of that. I just want to talk about the release, and then we'll end this and share some thoughts and questions and responses. When the movie was released, Alfred Hitchcock started this incredible publicity stunt that no one would be admitted to the theater after the first 5 minutes of the movie starting. I have no idea if theaters really did do that, but he threatened to send spies and fine the theater if they did. They also created a 6.5-minute trailer, which has Alfred Hitchcock in it as a tour guide. He takes us through the Bates Motel and through the shower scene and through the Bates Mansion and talks about all the horrible things that happened with his usual very fiendish glee. The movie opened in June of 1960 at two theaters in New York, the DeMille in the Times Square area, the Baronet on the Upper East Side. And immediately the movie was a hit. The lines were around the block for every performance, partially because of the New York Times review, which says the first line of it is, "You'd better have a pretty strong stomach and be prepared for a couple of grisly shocks when you go to see Psycho." Well, everybody wanted to see that movie. And then just at the very end, there are a couple of controversial scenes. Hitchcock didn't originally want this ending, but compromised on it because people didn't really quite understand the Norman Bates character and dressing as his mother. And so there's this scene with a psychiatrist and trying to explain all this Freudian stuff. And there's a great moment that we can find funny now where one of the lawyers, one of the policemen says, "You mean he's a transvestite?" And it seemed very funny with modern sensibility, but the psychiatrist explains that that's not really the truth. And those of you who've seen it recently and have a very sharp eye may have noticed that Ted Knight from the Mary Tyler Moore Show plays one of the prison guards. So that was just kind of a fun little thing. And the very final scene is, of course, Norman, who's now in a catatonic state. He's totally like lost his own personality and he's become his mother in his head. And he sits there, you know, not moving, not speaking, talking about how he won't even swat the fly on his hand because he wants them to see how delicate he is. And he gives us this very demonic image that actually fades into a quick shot of his mother's corroded skeleton. It goes by very quickly, but it's not the last image in the movie, which Hitchcock wanted. The last image in the movie is this. It's the car with Marion's body and the $40,000 being pulled out of a swamp. Paramount released the film, although they wouldn't fund it, but they insisted that the $40,000 be recovered. They could not let that $40,000 just be sort of faded away. So Hitchcock always referred to it as the $40,000 MacGuffin. It's what the film company cared about, but he didn't. And then lastly, I just wanted some images of Alma Revile, his wife, who really was the sort of co-conspirator on this film. And I want to end with one more personal connection, and then we'll open it up for conversation. In about 2000, I went to Orlando with my two older sisters because they wanted to go on vacation together with me, and that was where they decided to go. And we went to all the usual things, Disney and Epcot. But at that time, the Universal Studios had a theater called the Alfred Hitchcock Theater, which was about the art of making movies. And for every performance, I think they had a show every hour, somebody would get pulled off the line to be part of a sort of onstage joke. And it was me that time. So my family got to sit first row center. They pulled me off. And the idea is that I was going to be dressed as Norman Bates's mother. and they put me in a rocking chair that would turn around mechanically, and I was surrounded by a shower curtain. And when the shower curtain went up and the rocking chair turned around and I'd be there dressed as Norman Bates' mother, everybody would scream. Sounds like a good idea, right? Well, I'll guess again. What they didn't tell me was that when the shower curtain went up and the rocking chair turned around, somebody would come at me, rushing at me, dressed as Norman Bates, with a rubber knife stabbing down at me. I was so unnerved by this that I clocked him in the face, sending him backwards, and had to tell the crowd, who was like confused, that this is not part of the show. So that was my sort of closing personal connection. So I'm going to stop sharing. And I know I've kind of talked a little bit longer than I planned to, but I hope you found it informative and entertaining and not at all scary. And we have almost, we have about 15 minutes, maybe 20 minutes if we push it, for discussion, questions, concerns. My question to you all is, why this movie? Why do people love it? What do you like about it, considering how sad and unsavory it is? Or maybe you don't like it. Maybe you hate it. Let's have some dialogue.
Thank you very much for that, Alan. I just want to share, David Picker said, this has been interesting. Thank you. Okay.
You're welcome.
And I just want to share also the reason that I even became interested in seeing this movie was because I went on the Universal Studios tour in Hollywood, where they have the Bates Motel and house. And we were just like driving by, and all of a sudden a Norman Bates character comes out to put the body in the back of the car and sees like our tour tram, and he runs up and he jumps on my row like he's about to stab us. And when we got back from that trip, I got a DVD of Psycho and watched it, and the rest is history.
Yeah, I don't know why they think that's funny. I don't know why they do. It's demented, but so is the movie.
All right. What does anyone have anything they want to say? Cheryl?
Sorry, I feel like I'm talking again. The one thing that bothered me about the movie is that poor Marion gets killed after she decides to do the right thing and go back and give back the money. That's what she's tallying up, like how much is she going to have to come up with? And then here she's going to do the right thing, and she gets, you know, she gets killed anyway. And yeah. And I think, like, one of the things that I always think of, even in the movie, the slasher movies that you see nowadays, it's, oh, and way back to like Friday the 13th and all that kind of stuff, it's always the person that has the illicit sex that has to get killed, right? So I feel like Marion, because she had this affair, which to me, it's crazy. They, in that, you know, today's setting, right? They're both unmarried. He's divorced. I mean, like, why they have to go sneak off, except of the time period. But it's like that same old kind of thing. She's the woman. She had sex out of wedlock. So therefore, she's going to have to die by the end of the movie anyway to make it all right.
Well, I think the point is that she dies in the middle of the movie, and Hitchcock wanted us to have this completely ruptured experience that the person, you know, she's going to go back to Phoenix the next morning and make it right. She's going to do that. But talk about bad luck, you know. So, you know, maybe the moral is don't have illicit sex and don't steal $40,000. But I don't know. It seems like a personal choice to me.
I think that show put a finger on one of the reasons why we like this movie so much, is because it's so challenging and so unconventional. And so, you know, it's not, she doesn't get killed, you know, oh, she had illicit sex or she stole the money. She's decided to give the money back, and then she gets killed. And, yeah. And it is just a complete kind of reversal of what we want to happen, because at that point we're really rooting for her. And then, then the other thing is just the shocking surprises. Yeah. You know, no one saw that coming. No one saw that coming. And I think that's the the appeal of the movie that it just through the decades it just continues to appeal.
Yeah, and I've seen this movie at least 20 times, and even as recently as seeing it last week, as soon as she, you know, opens the bar of soap and pulls the shower curtain, it's like, no, don't do that, please don't do that. But I can't help her. I'm you know, I'm the victim that Hitchcock wants to feel, you know, somehow powerless, I guess. I don't know.
I think the particular moment, the shot that makes that the shower scene so powerful, is that she not only has decided that she's going to do the right thing and go back, but like when she first turns on the shower and like, you know, she's like cleansing herself of like whatever morally wrong thing she did. And like her expression on her face is so like, she's freed of this burden now.
Yeah.
That moment is like what like kills us.
You know, the Freudian French semiotic, you know, film critics would certainly agree with you that all of that is in there. I have to admit, I don't think of any of that when I see this movie. I just think, oh my God, she's in the wrong place at the wrong time. And you know, I know the movie does have mythic psychological complex layers, but somehow I never really think of those. I'm so swept up in her story that I don't always think of that. But there are decades of film historians who would agree with you for sure.
Julia.
So I really like this movie. And as Kyle knows, I'm also a scaredy cat. So every time I watch this movie, I always get freaked out when I shower right afterward. But in addition to the shower scene, the thing that unnerves me the most is when you see his smile right before it changes to his mom. But when he makes the eye contact, and I remember watching that for the first time and it turning to my dad, like, what is going on there?
Yeah.
So that, I think it's because you feel like, oh, you're safe. He's with the doctors now. It's all going to be okay.
Not safe, and he's not okay.
Yeah, but I wanted to ask you about that and also about Anthony Perkins and his career, because I think his performance is really part of what makes this movie so long lasting.
Yeah, I agree with you about that. Just to go back on the scary thing, the only thing in this movie, I don't love watching the shower scene. I sort of have to watch that through my fingers. But the one thing I cannot look at the screen for is when Norman Bates' mother turns around and it's that hideous, corroded, taxidermic skeleton. I cannot look at that. That's just too creepy for me. But yeah, Anthony Perkins was a terrific actor who had a long and vital career, but I don't think he ever did anything that overshadowed this particular role. If the film that's about the making of this movie and some of the documentation of the making of this movie is to be believed, you know, he was known to be gay, although he was married and had children. But Hitchcock, what Hitchcock liked about him, even at the audition stage, was that he felt like Anthony Perkins had a secret that he wasn't quite sharing. And I don't know, again, if we can psychologize both Hitchcock and Perkins and say that's what made his performance so exceptional. I don't know that's true, but I do think Anthony Perkins was a really detailed, fine actor who his lifelong passion, frankly, was games and gaming. If you've ever seen a movie that he co-wrote with Stephen Sondheim called The Last of Sheila, it's a terrific whodunit thriller that's all about playing games, psychological games, board games, other games. And so he had a very, you know, varied career. He made a lot of movies in Europe, movies with Melina Mercouri, movies with Ingrid Bergman. And very often he was the young juvenile who was having an affair with an older, sophisticated European woman, which is, you know, a recurring theme in his work. But he had a really wide variety of roles and worked constantly, but I don't think his work ever rose above this. So that's all I can share about him that I know of.
I just want to point out too that just a couple of years after he was finished with Psycho, he was in Orson Welles' adaptation of The Trial as Joseph
Yes.
Kent, which is
Yes. I think he also starred in at least one, if not two, sequels. There was a Psycho 2, I'm pretty sure he was in, and maybe a Psycho 3. I didn't see either of them. I also did not see, sorry if I'm being, you know, blunt about this, but Gus Van Sant made a technicolor remake of Psycho that was a shot-by-shot repeat. Like, nothing was different. It's the exact same movie, but in color with different actors. And at one point, early on in that production, he asked Jamie Lee Curtis if she would play Marion Crane. And her response was, not only won't I be in it, I won't even see it. Which I think is appropriate.
Cheryl, I just want to point out in the chat, she said, I love the tip of the hand when Marion has dinner with him and he gets angry at her for talking about putting his mother in a home. That whole parlor scene, Cheryl, yeah. That's got like the heart of the movie.
It really is. And you know, he reveals things that he then realizes he shouldn't say, like, you know, a boy's best friend is his mother. He suddenly realized that sounds strange. Or he talks about his hobby not being a pastime, but filling his time. And, you know, he's really a terribly sad character. It's impossible for me to not feel some compassion for him, even though he's done some very, very, very terrible things. And I think that kind of moral uncertainty is Hitchcock's way of playing with us. I think, you know, he really was kind of sadistic, by the way. He loved playing not very funny practical jokes on people. He was famous for really being kind of, I don't know, mean-spirited.
I don't know if this is apocryphal, but he like tested out different like corpses for mother on what's her name, Vera Miles. Like they would put like different like corpse in her trailer each day, and whichever one got the loudest scream is the one that went into the movie.
I don't know that, but that sounds about right. I do know that it wasn't on Psycho, it was on The Birds. He bet the camera operator that he couldn't spend a night alone in the studio chained to the camera. And the guy said, of course I could do that. And Hitchcock gave him a flagon of brandy that was laced with a powerful emetic, you know, which is the kind of thing Hitchcock thought was funny, but I'm sure the cameraman didn't.
Jana.
I'm curious, Alan, what you... if you can recall what you took away from this as a five-year-old, like how much did your five-year-old self get what was going on? How did that impact you psychologically and so forth?
Well, I'm not prepared to reveal the psychological trauma that still haunts me today. And I don't remember what I thought about the movie, but I do know this. I'm so glad you asked that question. My little bratty five-year-old self noticed that whenever I told adults that I saw Psycho, they would get very upset. They'd be like, oh my God. And I kind of liked that. I kind of got off on that. So I was in the habit of telling people, oh yes, I saw Psycho. and really, really enjoying their like disturbed reaction. So That's what I can share with you. And my sister who took me, she was supposed to be here tonight. I don't know if she made it or not, but you know, she's a great big sister. She was always taking me to things, specifically movies. But I'm not sure my mother knew she took me to that one. I don't think my mother would have liked it too much. So that's what Psycho did for me. And before we close, which we really have to do very quickly, although I could, you know, I could talk about this movie all night, but how about some of you? What are your sort of, you know, psycho impressions? What did Psycho do for you? if anyone would care to share their sort of reaction.
If I can, I don't know how to get the little hand up. Jean, here. I really enjoyed this session. I think the movie really appeals to some basic fears that we have inside us all the time. I remember the first few motels I have ever went to, and I hadn't seen Psycho. I kept thinking, somebody must be looking, or will somebody walk in here, or there's that basic fear. And I remember a trip in Upper State New York. It was a stormy night, and I happened to go into this place, and I didn't. The guy at the desk, I will never forget. So the thought that I had, well, I had one question about the house. Was it modeled on a real house? And the second point I want to make is, I wonder if it affected the economy of motels when it came out. Did this stop people from going into some of these motels? We still see some of them if you travel around that look a bit like that, that I would never go in there.
Yeah, I don't think there's any motel, data on that. You might want to ask Tom Baudet. But yes, there are still thousands of motels like that, even as close as Princeton, where I know you live. If you drive up and down Route 1, which luckily is a major traveled road, there's lots of these little things. But what was the first part of your question? Because I did have the house. Yeah. I don't think it's modeled on a specific house, but it's the classic Gothic, Adams family shape. It's got that central turret, and it's painted pigeon gray. And so it kind of has that, morbid Gothic pre-Stephen King kind of, like, who in their right mind would enter that house willingly? Clearly nothing good happens there. And I'm right. Nothing good did happen there.
Thank you.
Anyway, I guess we're probably out of time, so I'm going to turn it over to our hosts to sort of wrap things up.
Before I do that, I just want to point out one little thing based on what Gene said about motels. A moment in Psycho that they talk about is how ever since the highway came in, like, they get like fewer and fewer guests. So it's interesting that is like part of the plot of Psycho, is that the seclusion provided by like the different like traveling routes like allows for him to like to carry out his murders.
And that is an important plot point, because Marion says, I must have gotten off the main road, and if it weren't for the seclusion of the Bates Motel, it couldn't happen. Also, before we go, I just have to say one detail I never noticed is when the detective comes, Norman is sitting there with a bag labeled candy corn. He's eating candy corn, and it's just, I don't know why that I find that funny, something about that.
The shot of him when he's eating that candy corn and he's like looking at her signing the guest book, the way is crazy.
Yeah, he's like upside down and it's you're making me want to see it again.
The eating the candy corn was Anthony Perkins' suggestion to Hitchcock too.
Oh, wow, really? I
didn't know that. Yeah. That's awesome. That's what a good actor can do. Those instincts are priceless.
I want to say, Eric, I like your shirt as well.
Thank you.
All right, I guess it's time for us to hit the hay here. Thanks everyone for joining. Like I said, if you do want to see Psycho again, it's playing this Thursday at the Ambler. The next deep focus is the setup with Hannah Jack from Turner Classic Movies. That deep focus is next Tuesday, November 7th. Thank you all. Have a good night.